Everyone, Dr. Beena here. Today we are going to discuss some questions from water and electrolyte balance, then tumor markers. Important questions came for the university are distribution of total body water, normal values of serum electrolytes like sodium, potassium, bicarbonate and chloride. Mention the normal sodium level and clinical manifestation of hyponatremia. Define the tumor markers and mention examples. These are the question came, but anything can be asked from these topics. But we are discussing mainly this thing, and you can refer the previous videos if you want to study well. So the water constitutes about the 60% of the weight of the body. So in a person, 60% body weight is constituted by water. Now the human body contains about 60 to 70% of water and about 8.5% of minerals. Minerals include relatively large sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium, phosphorus, chloride and sulfur, and small amounts of iron, copper, cobalt, manganese, zinc, selenium, iodide, fluoride, chromium and molybdenum. This is how the distribution of water and electrolytes in the body. Now the body water, how it is distributed, that was one question came for the university. So the total body water, as we already said, 60% of the total body weight, it constitutes about 42 liters. So it is again divided into intracellular and extracellular. Intracellular 28 liters and extracellular 14 liters. Intracellular is 40% of the body weight and the extracellular is 20% of the body weight. Then the extracellular is again divided into intravascular and extravascular. Intravascular means inside the blood vessels, that is around 2.8 liters or 4%, and the extracellular may be the interstitial fluid and other fluids, that is constituting 16%, that is 11.2 liters. So in this diagram also you can see the various distribution of intracellular fluid and extracellular fluid in this water. The intracellular fluid and extracellular fluid are called the fluid compartments because they behave as a distinct entity. So intracellular fluid, 40% of the body weight is constituted by water, and the interstitial fluid is 16%, and the plasma around 40%, that is in the blood. So these together forms the extracellular fluid. Now in this diagram you can see the input and output of water. So it is almost equal, 2500 ml. So the average intake per day is the 2500 ml, which is formed by the intake of fluids, that is 1500 ml, then from foods around 750 ml, and during metabolism of various biomolecules 250 ml, together constitute 2500 ml. Similarly the output also is 2500 ml, out of which 1500 ml is in the urine, that is 60%, others are feces 4%, sweat around 8%, that is 200 ml, and then the insensible losses of via skin and the lungs, that is without our knowledge some amount of water is escaped through the skin and also through the lungs, that correspondingly 28%. So again it total comes 2500 ml. Now the ionic composition of the body fluids, how it is distributed, that is which are the intracellular ions and extracellular, which is the major ions. So we are in this table, both cations are separately shown and the anions are separately shown. Cations again is divided in the plasma and the interstitial fluid, and again in the intracellular compartment. Similarly here the plasma, interstitial fluid and the intracellular fluid, like that it is divided. You can refer and see, and you can see which is the more in the plasma, that is sodium. Cations, among the cations sodium is more in the plasma, and the potassium is more in the cells. So you can see the difference. Similarly in anions, chloride is seen in the plasma and interstitial fluid more, but phosphate that is seen more in the cell. So hypophosphate, it is present as hypophosphate, it is present in the intracellular compartment more. So that is anion. So again, this table also, you can see the various values of sodium, potassium, calcium, which are the cations, and the chloride bicarbonate protein, which are the anions, and how they are distributed in the plasma, interstitial fluid, and intracellular compartment. You can see very well in the plasma and interstitial fluid, sodium is more, but potassium is more in the intracellular compartment. Similarly, bicarbonate is more in the plasma and interstitial fluid, and then the protein is more in the intracellular compartment. So the principal ions in the extracellular fluid are sodium and chloride and bicarbonate, and intracellular fluid contains an abundance of potassium, magnesium, phosphorus ions, and negatively charged proteins. So like that it is distributed in the body. We can have a overall look at this, and the important things you have to remember is the sodium, potassium, and bicarbonate and chloride. So sometimes one more question can come as the normal value of serum electrolytes. So then, so normal serum level of sodium is 136 to 145 milliequivalents per liter. Remember, electrolytes always expressed in milliequivalents per liter or millimoles per liter. Then the serum potassium level is 3.5 to 5 milliequivalents per liter, and then the normal serum chloride, that is 96 to 106 milliequivalents per liter, and the bicarbonate level is 22 to 26 milliequivalents per liter. So these values you have to remember. It will be always useful when you discuss the clinical charts, where the values will be given, so, and then that time you have to find out whether it is elevated or decreased. So for that you have to study the normal value. Remember always, it is expressed in milliequivalents per liter. Now, second part is regarding sodium. Since osmolality is dependent on the number of the solute particles, the major determinant factor is the sodium. Therefore, sodium and water balance are dependent on each other and cannot be considered separately. So the major solute in the plasma or is the sodium. So it will be going along with water in the various, for maintaining the osmolality of the body. So it is maintained by the kidney, which excretes either water or solute as the case may be. So by kidney has got a major role in the regulation of sodium and water balance. We have studied in details in physiology and also renin angiotensin mechanism. So many things are there to regulate the water and electrolyte balance of the body. So sodium is one among the important electrolyte. Sodium regulates the extracellular fluid volume. Then the total body sodium is about 4000 milliequivalents, and about 50% of it is present in the bone, and only 40% is in the extracellular fluid, and 10% is seen in the soft tissue. So like that sodium is distributed in our body. Sodium is the major cation in the extracellular fluid. So that we have already studied. And now what is the other importance of sodium? Sodium pump is operating in all the cells so as to keep the sodium extracellular. And this mechanism is usually ATP dependent. Sodium potassium, ATPase, and sodium pump is also working in the presence of ATP. Then sodium as sodium bicarbonate is also important in the regulation of acid-base balance. That also we have studied, which is the important thing in the acid-base regulation buffers, where the bicarbonate buffer is the important one, and it is present as sodium bicarbonate level. So normal level of sodium in the plasma, that is you have studied, 136 to 145 milliequivalents per liter, and in cells it is only 12 milliequivalents. Inside the cell only 12, so it is an extracellular ion. Now, what are the causes of hyponatremia? Actually, the question was clinical manifestation. So, before going to the clinical manifestation, you can write something regarding the causes. So, important causes are vomiting, diarrhea, burns, then Addison's disease, that is adrenal insufficiency, renal tubular acidosis, reabsorption of sodium is defective there, then chronic renal failure, nephrotic syndrome, then congestive cardiac failure, hyperglycemia and ketoacidosis, excess non-electrolyte, that is IV, glucose infusion, then syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone and defective antidiuretic hormone secretion. CIA, then the condition where the defective ADH is there. Then pseudo or dilutional hyponatremia and hypoproteinemia. These are the important causes, of which most important we come across is this after vomiting, diarrhea, burns and etc. And some renal pathology also will produce hyponatremia in the clinical condition. So there are some drugs also which may cause hyponatremia, that is angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, and then non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, and then vasopressin or oxytocin, and chlorpromazine. These are some of the drugs which continuously after using, they may lead on to hyponatremia. So the physician should be aware of these drugs which may cause the hyponatremia also. So these are the important causes. Now, what are the types? Types hyponatremia due to water retention. That is the commonest one. You can see the patient coming with pedal edema and all. Then the second is the hypertonic hyponatremia. Shift of water from the intracellular compartment to the extracellular fluid compartment. Here, water is shifted from the intracellular to the extracellular compartment. Examples, hyperglycemia, decreased, that is in case of diabetes or hyperglycemia, decrease in 1.6 milliequivalents per liter of sodium for every 100 milligram rise of glucose above 100 milligram per deciliter. So this is the picture where you can see. So suppose there is a patient is diabetic and above his blood sugar is above 100, say suppose it is 200 milligram, there will be a decrease of 1.6 millimoles per liter of sodium. So then suppose the normal value is 136, there will be decreasing of 1.6 milliliters, millimoles per liter occurs if there is a rise of 100 milligram, that is above the 100 milligram normal level. Then normotonic hyponatremia, severe lipidemia, paraproteinemia can lead on to low sodium with normal osmolality due to the fall in the water in the plasma. So that is condition where normotonic hyponatremia occurs, hyperlipidemia and paraproteinemia. Then hypotonic hyponatremia, what is the meaning of that? Due to inability of the kidney to handle the excess water consumed orally. Suppose we are drinking lot of water and the kidney is little weak and it cannot excrete the amount. So in that condition, dilutional hyponatremia, that is hypotonic hyponatremia also occurs. So the types are hyponatremia due to water retention, hypertonic hypernatremia, then normotonic hyponatremia and hypotonic hyponatremia. Now the question was the clinical manifestation of hyponatremia. So it is usually come across in our clinics. Patient may brought with all these symptoms. Low BP, sudden fall of BP, thirst, patient may be feeling thirst, then drowsiness, lethargy and confusion. He may not be remembering things. He may be not be remembering the name of the his daughter or son or something like that. Some confusion. Then abdominal cramps, tremor and oliguria. The output of urine will be less. Then finally, the stage may come where there is coma. So these are the common symptoms. Patient may be brought with confusion. Usually confusion, drowsiness, lethargy, fall of BP, and there will be intensive thirst also. So So suppose they are not in the casualty, we have to see the serum electrolytes and the blood sugar, everything we have to see. But when you look at the serum electrolyte study, then you will get the value as low. So treatment is depending upon the cause, duration and the severity. So the cause is one matter, and there is the duration, how much time is there in the stage, and the severity, whether it is severe. The duration means acute or chronic onset, suddenly came or slowly the patient came to the drowsiness coma like that. Then severity, if it is very severe in the coma state, we have to treat accordingly. In acute stage, rapid correction is possible. If the patient suddenly developed hyponatremic symptoms, then rapid correction is possible. And chronic stage, rapid correction is dangerous and may lead on to the neurological complications. Suppose the patient is slowly developing all these signs, then if you are going to correct it immediately, suddenly, then that may produce some dangerous condition, the neurological complications. So slowly you have to correct. Then monitor the dose given and also give sufficient time to see the effect. So slowly you monitor and give time to get it adjusted. So if you are giving sodium, then you have to wait for some time and then to see the effect. It will take around 4 to 6 hours for the redistribution. So immediately after giving the sodium, or if you are giving in the drip, suddenly there won't be correction. So it will take some time, 4 to 6 hours for the redistribution. Water restriction and increased salt intake and anti-ADH and furosemide are the other method of treatment. So when there is water intoxication, we have to restrict the water intake, then increase the salt intake. The salt can be given only, and then NDADH drugs are given, and also furosemide to increase the diuretic, that will produce diuretic effect and the water will be removed. So these are the important part in the treatment. So that finishes the water and electrolyte balance. In the water balance, again you have to see what are the hypotonic expansion, hypertonicity and osmolarity, etc. You have to just go through that, and then sometimes question may come in that also. Now the next question came, we are adding in this is the tumor markers. You know what are the tumor markers? So whenever you are asked to write about tumor markers, you have to define properly. So the definition is very important. It is defined as a biochemical substance, either hormones, enzymes or proteins synthesized and released by cancer cells or produced by the host in response to cancerous substance and are used to monitor or identify the presence of a cancerous growth. So this is the full definition of the tumor marker. And you have to study this whenever you are asked to write anything about the tumor marker. Then where is it seen? It is maybe present in blood, body cavity fluid, cell membranes and cell cytoplasm. So not only in the blood, it is seen in the tissues also and also body cavity fluids. They are different from the substance produced by normal cells in their quantity and quality. So they are separate thing. If it is hormone, if it is present in quantity and quality, it will be different. So there are some various types of tumor markers either, that also you have to know. So what is the importance of doing the estimation of tumor markers? Tumor markers are used for determining the prognosis, determining the effectiveness of cancer treatment, for the detecting recurrent cancers, that is after sometimes again cancer recur, then early detection of the cancer. And the tumor markers are sometimes elevated in non-malignant condition also. So not every tumor will cause a rise in the tumor level of this associated marker, especially in the early stages of the some cancers. That is why question mark came. Sometimes it will present in the later stage also only. Sometimes false positive also may come. So you have to mention all these things when you are asked to write a 5-mark question in the for the tumor markers. So the main thing is determining the prognosis, determining the effectiveness of the cancer treatment. While treating the cancer, you have to seriously estimate the level of the tumor marker, whether it is decreasing or increasing, so, and can find out the effectiveness of the treatment. Then recurrence, secondary, whether it is developing or not, that also you can find out. Early detection, of course, is there along with other symptomatic things and other lab findings. You can correlate, and sometimes it may not be positive in some cases. Now, you have to give the examples of various common tumor markers. Sometimes they will ask 4, sometimes 2, sometimes only 1. So depending upon the question, you have to write. So before that, you have to know what are the types. Oncofetal products are there, carbohydrate antigens are there, enzymes are there. So accordingly, you can mention the name of the tumor marker and the serum level increased in which condition, like that. So the oncofetal products are alpha-fetoprotein and carcinoembryonic antigen. Alpha-fetoprotein increased in hepatoma or germ cell cancer. CEA is in the colorectal and gastrointestinal or lung cancer. Then carbohydrate antigens are CA125. So it is an ovarian cancer of epithelial origin. It's present in ovarian cancer of epithelial origin. And then tissue antigens, tissue polypeptide antigens are there for the general cancer load. So it is not a specific one. Now there are enzymes which are acting as the tumor markers. Alkaline phosphatase in bone secondaries, placental alkaline phosphatase, Regan isoenzymes in lung and seminoma, prostatic acid phosphatase in prostatic cancer, prostatic specific antigen in prostate cancer, and neuron specific enolase in nervous system tumors. Then some serum proteins are also acting as the tumor markers. So immunoglobulins in multiple myeloma and Benson's proteins in urine also is in, seen in multiple myeloma. Then receptor tumor markers, they are very important nowadays. Estrogen receptor ER, and that is mainly in the carcinoma breast, and progesterone receptor PR in the carcinoma uterus and carcinoma breast, and HER2 NU or ARB2 or EGFR2. These are the one which is also tumor marker of the carcinoma breast. So you have to not only mention the name of the tumor marker, you have to mention the tumor in which it is elevated. That is very important, otherwise you won't get mark. Simply writing alpha beta protein CA125 CEA like that, you have to write which tumor will produce these tumor markers, like that. So you read the thoroughly the tumor marker and write accordingly. If it is asked for 4 mark, you have to mention all these things. And if it is small, 1 mark question, then 1 example and if definition alone is enough. So like that, you have to adjust your answer. Now, I have just shown a table where monoclonal antibodies used in the anti-cancer agents. Simply, I have shown, you can refer later on, which are the drugs used and the target where it is acting and used in against which cancer. So that is usually, I think we will be dealt with discussing the cancer. Anyway, so many drugs are there, rituximab, trastuzumab, baricitin, or bevacizumab, alemtuzumab, and cetuximab, pendimab, and the imatinib. These are the important drugs. Monoclonal antibodies. Sometimes monoclonal antibodies can be asked as a 4-mark question. So study this with the corresponding target cells and then the which cancer it is used for. Okay. That is chemotherapy of cancer coming along. That much regarding the revision part. You have to read the book thoroughly and answer. Thank you.